Hello all, welcome to this course on computer organization. The topics we will be seeing today are single cycle data path for store instruction and single cycle data path for R type instruction. So when we move on to the next slide, you can see that the design given here is in a gray color. So we'll start off this discussion with an assumption that you are already familiar with the single cycle data path for a load instruction. If you're not, you can go through my previous video that I've uploaded on the same. So I've discussed all the steps, like from the beginning to the end in big details, like how to do the designing part. So what we are doing in this video is we are trying to extend from the design that has already been done for the load instruction to get your store instruction design. So like a load instruction, your store also reads the base address from port 1 of your register file, and it also sign extends the immediate value. Your ALU will add this base address and the immediate value to find the memory address. So all these functions are already supported by even your load instruction. So the difference comes here in the place that your store instruction also reads the second register from the register file, and then it writes it to your data memory. So that second register is specified in your RT field. RT field is your destination here. And yes, so that is the address that's loaded into your A2 port, and these bits are connected to your register read A2 port, which is reading the register value to your RD2 port. So this RD2 port is connected to your write data port of data memory, and you can see that the write enable port of your data memory is controlled by a mem write signal. For your mem write signal, possible values are 1 and 0. So when the value is 1, actually it writes data to your memory. And next you see the ALU control, it is 0 and 0. So in load 2 we had the value of ALU is 010, that is given for the addition of your base address and the sign immediate. So that remains the same here. Also, you can see that you have your reg write signal here in the register file. That value will be 0 because you have nothing to be written to your register. You are writing it to your data memory. Also, you can see that the value here, that is the data, is still read from this address A onto this RD, which is derived into read data, but we ignore it. The reason is your reg write value is 0, so because that value is written to your register file, since it's 0, that's ignored. Okay, next. Yeah, we are just trying to see the steps involved during single cycle data path designing for a store instruction. This step 5 will be the extra step that's coming in when you compare it with the load instruction. And also, we have added the general format for an ITEP instruction and also the truth table for an ALU 3-bit. So now we'll try to derive single cycle data path for your R type instruction from the design of store instruction. So R type instructions like add, subtract, and or even SLT. SLT stands for set less than. So this is the general format for your R type instruction. First 6 bits stands for opcode. RS source 5 bits, RT also another source 5 bits, RD is your destination 5 bits, shift amount 5 bits, and function 6 bits. So the operation done by your instruction is stored in OP value and funct value. So for all R-type instructions, the value of OP will be 0. So you can differentiate between different R-type instructions using this funct value. Then you have two source registers, RS and RT. The destination is RD. And SHAMT is shift amount. Like when you use the instruction shift, like shift left or shift right, shift amount will show the number of bits you have to shift to the left or to the right. And other times its value is 0. So when you look into generally like what happens in an R-type instruction, all the instructions read two registers from the register file. They'll perform some ALU operation on them. They write the result back to the another register. That's the third register. So three registers are used here. Actually, all these differ only in the specific ALU operation they do. So we can say that all of them can be handled by the same hardware using different ALU control signals. Why? Because each ALU operation will vary. Next, we'll see what are the modifications that are coming up in your previous design. So when you look into this design, you can see that here your register file will have two reads, like two register inputs, two inputs here, and your ALU will perform an operation on these two registers. So in the previous cases, like that is like for your load or even for your store, this SRCB value came from your sign extended immediate value. But you have seen that there are two source registers. So A1 and A2 will be those two. So since you already have A1 and you are having a new A2, A2 will have a value at RD2. So this will be another input. So it can be either RD2 or the sign extended immediate. That can be the second input. So what you do is you insert a multiplexer there to choose from either the RD2 port or the sign immediate. Since it's a multiplexer, you need a select line. Here, your select line is named as ALUSRC. So when the value of the signal is 0, it supports an R-type instruction and it chooses SRCB from your register file RD2. And when its value is 1, it stands for your load or store operation and choose sign extended immediate as its SRCB. So this principle of enhancing the data path capabilities by adding a multiplexer to choose input from several possible options is actually very useful. So yeah, we'll see another multiplexer here. Let's see what's the reason for that. So earlier your register file always got its write data from your data memory, but in R-type instruction what happens is it writes the ALU result to the register file. So what you do is you add a multiplexer here to choose between the read data or the ALU result. So this read data line was significant in case of load instruction because this was the final value that you wrote into the register. But in R-type instructions, ALU result is the one that is written. So you have added multiplexer here with a control line mem to reg. If it's 0, it stands for the R-type instruction and the value written to the register will be ALU result. And if its value is 1, it stands for load instruction and it will choose this read data that is to be written to you, this register. We can see that we didn't discuss about the store instruction. Why? Because it doesn't write to the register. It writes to the data memory. And you see one more multiplexer here. And if you take the earlier case, the register to write was specified by the RT field. So here, this was the destination for load store instructions, I type. But you can see here that here your destination is RD, and just check the bits that stand for each of these. In the case of I-type instruction, the bits were from 16 to 20, bits 16 to 20 of your instruction. And in case of R-type, it's 11 to 15. Okay, so there comes the need for adding another multiplexer into it. So we had a third multiplexer to choose the value that is to be written to the register, which is again controlled by another control signal, that is reg DST. So if its value is 1, it stands for the R-type instruction, and the value that is written to the register will be bits 11 to 15, this value. And when your reg DST is 0, it stands for your load instruction, and the bits written to the register will be from 16 to 20. Again, we don't care about the store instruction because it doesn't write to the register file, it writes only to your data memory. So same thing is explained here again. So that's how you do a single cycle data path for R-type instructions. So let's just brief up what we just discussed. So for a store instruction, you need just to add an extra line for your already derived load design. What you did is, you had a second register value, it's address at A2, that is instruction with 16 to 20. You read its value to RD2 and you pass that value to WD port of your data memory. So that value is written there. That's the extra addition that came there. When you generalize it for R-type, you can see that you have to cater to the needs of both the R-type and the I-type instructions. I-type is the load store instruction and rest of the R-type instruction. So what you did here is, you found out that all the R-type instructions require two sources and one destination. So that was the general idea. But you also could see that they differed in the source and destination values, both the R-type and the I-type. So you decided to insert multiplexes to cater to the needs of both types of instructions. So here you see that SRCB can have two possible values, either value from RD2 for R-type or the sign extended immediate value for load and store. So you give a multiplex there with the control line ALUSRC. If it's 0, it stood with the R-type, and if it's 1, it stood for the load and store. Next, you see another multiplexer insert here, because for load instruction, the value written to the register was read data. But in the case of an R-type instruction, the ALU result is written to the register. So there came a multiplexer with a control line mem to reg, whose value was 0, then the R-type instruction is signified there. Or when the value is 1, then the read data will be written to your register file. Then we saw a third multiplexer here. So this one was deciding on which value is to be written to the destination register. Is it the RT value for your I-type instruction or RD value for your R-type? So if it's, values from 15, that's bits 11 to 15, then the value of regdest is 1. That will be the value written to your destination register, and that stood for your R-type instruction. And if the value of reg DST is 0, then the bits from 16 to 20 is written to your register. So that's how we design single cycle data path. Thank you for listening.